Our apologies for way too much Marty and myself yesterday. I mean, we just ended up with an Instigators doggy bag, Marty. We couldn't stop talking, so today we're trying to offset it by having more guests. Started the show with Rasmus Dahlin. Tripp Tracy, longtime Canes broadcaster, is with us now. On the heels
former
of...
Goalie. Former goalie. Don't forget the goalie part.
I had a feeling you'd go there, Marty, so I was leaving you something, but he's also a very big fan of Rick Jeanneret, so he's been pretty active on social media lately. How nice was it to have a quick run-in with RJ today?
Duffer, Marty, so great to see you guys. And by the way, exceptional job in both of your capacities on RJ night. It was super to see him. He had me from hello with his captivating, iconic call that I really first started paying attention to in the pre-scouts when I got the job in 1998. He's in a league, a stratosphere of his own. But what I've, and Marty and I were just talking about it, that I've appreciated the most in a wonderful friendship is there have been more than a few times that I've run into great Buffalonians around the league, road cities, maybe after having had a couple. And RJ has never... A, not answered the phone, and B, not spent a couple of minutes talking to these fans. And I don't know how many texts I got on Friday night from the people that, through my cell phone, had talked to RJ that said that they'll never forget that moment for the rest of their lives. So aside from being the creme de la creme in voices in the history of the game, it's being a man of the people and... Those occasions that I've been so privileged to share over my cell phone that I'll never forget, and that's why he is salt of the earth.
And so, we still feel that way every time we get to be around him on a game day. Yeah. Like, what a feeling! It's so good.
I walked in this morning. He was sitting on my chair, right, and he's just having a conversation with Duffer. I'm like, well, you can sit right there. I'll go home. Like, you can take. He's like, no. I'm busy right now, and obviously he's being pulled in a lot of different directions because everybody wants to talk to him. But we unveiled on Friday at 12:30 that May Day was his greatest call. Like, they did the RJ bracket with the calls. You probably remember the May Day, the La 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 Fontaine. There were so many other calls. You worked with some great play-by-play people as well. What is it about RJ that just separates him, let's see, from some of these other calls that you hear around the league?
Passion. His love for the Buffalo Sabres. And just the energy pops like none other through the TV screen or, the long time, the simulcast, if you're listening to it on the radio. And I think that is unrivaled in every form and sense. I mean, I had the privilege of working for 20 years with an truly elite voice, and my partner John Forslund, Chuck Hayden, the president of our broadcast association and in the Hall of Fame, and now getting to work with a Buffalo native, one of the infinite people that grew up idolizing Rick Jeanneret and Mike Maniscalco. But it's that. He made me a Buffalo Sabres fan. And to tell you the truth, gentlemen, I mean, I can't help but reminisce. The only time I would ever root against RJ and the Buffalo Sabres would be if the Hurricanes were playing Buffalo in the conference final. I'll never forget, too, he had some type of a hand issue, so he put a blocker on his hand. That I will never forget. And he turned, I would never even think of it as a negative, but he turned it into an immense positive. He's the greatest.
He is. He absolutely is. I'm just so thrilled that you had a chance to run into it. There was certainly no guarantee he was going to be here this morning. No. And the fact that you were able to share a moment with him is terrific. Are you calling the game tonight? What's the deal? Because obviously we have Dan and Razor calling it on the radio side. It's an ESPN Plus Hulu exclusive on TV. What's your role tonight?
We're simulcasting as well. So we're doing radio, Mike Maniscalco and myself. And I believe that Mike has, being a Buffalo native, I told him on Saturday, I said, wouldn't it be great if we wore the RJ mock turtleneck? So on Sunday, I know he went all around Raleigh with that big frame that the guy I affectionately call the Big Rig has to locate one, not sure what size. And he was unsuccessful in finding suspenders, as was I, which is unbelievable for me because my dad passed away a few years ago, big RJ fan. First team I ever played on in Mite hockey was the Sabres in Michigan. And my dad had no hips, so he wore suspenders all the time. I found the mock turtleneck, but I couldn't find a set of suspenders. But, yeah, we're on the radio tonight.
But you called play-by-play on one of the earlier games this year. Did you not, on a night when it was on ESPN?
I did. I called one on radio and then two on television. One off a monitor.
Oh, that's fun.
Yeah, and I mean, like, the thing is, for play-by-play guys, there is no break, okay? Yeah. Like, you know, as hopefully we get more comfortable in our own skin as analysts, you do a different type of prep. It's trustworthy relationships, people that you really respect with given teams the way they view the game. But really, when the puck drops, it's your intuition, instinct of saying what you feel. But play-by-play guys, now that I have three games under my belt, you know, I remember the first TV game was against Vancouver. And, you know, you have, you know, names, and I think JT Miller and Brock Besser, 6 and 8 or 9, whatever it is, they look similar. You have to know who's a lefty, who's a righty. There's so much repetition and true work that goes on between games. Mm-hmm. I said the first game, which was an ESPN game, Duffer, my partner was my American Hockey League teammate, Shane Willis, before he graduated to the NHL. And the Canes got trounced. A rare off night for Carolina this year. We've been treated to cakewalk broadcasting. But they were down in the second period decidedly to Columbus. And I turned him to a commercial break during a commercial break, and I said, if I was ever doing play-by-play hungover, I'd walk out halfway through the second period. It's that tough.
And, of course, the irony in that is everyone for the first 70 years of doing play-by-play in NHL was hungover.
No, or they did it while drinking.
Well, that's how they offset the hangover. Yeah.
Hair of the dog.
Oh, honestly.
What about, you mentioned you did play-by-play and you're an analyst. And what about this Carolina team now that is at the top of the league when you consider them, Florida, Colorado, Calgary, there is some really good teams, but Carolina is one of the tops, and I'm not saying they're surprising me. I think they have their own identity and culture, and they're doing it a certain way. Other teams are not doing it the same way, but what do you see out of the Hurricanes this year that make you feel good about them?
Well, Marty, every team, you know, seems to talk, culture is a very popular word, and the day that Rod Brind'Amour became the coach, the culture absolutely changed. And you have a unique and priceless, advantageous relationship, you having played in the league as long as you did, between the head coach and the captain, whether it be currently or in the past. You'd be hard-pressed to find a coach with such a similar personality to his captain in Jordan Staal. They both played center, both lefties, you know, both 200-foot, you know, always in the Selke conversation. Rod won two of them. So you have that chemistry that you know better than me of the room being policed when it needs to be, the coach and the captain always thinking pretty much identically, and then you have superstars that just fall in line, you know, whether it be a Sebastian Aho, a young Andrei Svechnikov, an underrated Teuvo Teravainen. You've added Max Domi for depth at the trade deadline. At first, I thought at the deadline, Carolina would need some help on defense, but they've had some guys, I think, step up both at the NHL level and the American League level that made me think that if you could just add one piece up front, that was the area to do it. And so I think Domi was the appropriate choice. And then the all-important position of goal. Freddie Anderson has truly had a Vezina-like year. He has been that good. He comes to a new team. He was 8-0 in the first month in October, especially early in hockey games, so the Hurricanes haven't had to chase hockey games for the most part. He allows you to hang in, eventually play with the lead, not chase the game. And I think about the previous game against Buffalo, And the Hurricanes were in one of their toughest segments, not winning of the year. It was a Saturday night game before they went on a Western Canadian trip, and Antti Raanta came in and was underrated. He was sick that night and won the hockey game. And they go out and play really well in Winnipeg, Calgary, Edmonton. I don't know if they would have played so well if Antti hadn't won that last game at home. And everything about me, and I'd love to get your take on this, is that Freddie Anderson is going to bring it to the playoffs, but he hasn't won in the playoffs. So the biggest positive story for me for Carolina in the last month and a half to 2 months is that they have implicit trust in both goaltenders. And that is massive to me. Depending, you never know how things are going to go in the postseason. They're very, very deep at all positions. And, you know, it's an exciting time, you know, for all Hurricanes fans.
I think with Freddie Anderson, the big difference for him is he's playing on a team that can kind of lock it down defensively if they want to. Now, they have a lot of talent. The Hurricanes do. But with Toronto, it always felt like they got to that place in the playoffs and could never change their game to say, hey, we need to lock it down a little bit. Gave up a lot of scoring chances. And Freddie Anderson, you look at his saves above expectation. I mean, he is in the top 10 in the league, top five. He's been bordering up there. So, but for me, the look in front of him when it gets to the playoffs will be different. So I have full confidence in Freddie and the Hurricanes to make a run this year. Raanta is a good support for him, but I just don't see that you go into the playoffs thinking you have two goalies. I think you have one.
Oh, he's the one. Yeah. He is absolutely the one. And the Hurricanes haven't, gentlemen, they haven't had, I mean, who has? But they haven't had that kingpin that can go toe-to-toe with the Andrei Vasilevskis of the world, if it's Igor Shesterkin. You know, they've had good efforts, whether it be Mrazek and McElhinney, took them to a conference final. Mrazek, Reimer, Nedeljkovic. They haven't had that kingpin that can go toe-to-toe. I want to ask you one quick question about trust, because guy that you played against, Cam Ward, as soon as the Hurricanes signed Freddie Anderson, Cam texted me, he said, he's going to be great for Carolina. Mm-hmm. You know, the system is going to be one where he trusts the guys in front of him. Can you maybe speak about, like, the difference of if you have sort of trust in the guys in front of you in comparison to absolute trust?
Well, I mean, that's big, you know, for goalies. When I was in New York, John Tortorella was our coach, and we had a system where we locked things down. Like, we blocked a lot of shots. It was, you know, no giveaways, no unmanned rush. And I mean, I had probably my better numbers. And I was older and did not have the ability that I did when I was younger, but my numbers were so good. And I looked over to Hank Lundqvist, and I said, this is great playing this way. And he said, it is the only way you want to play as a goaltender. Now, I understand that some teams are going to open it up, and they're going to rely on their goalie. Shesterkin right now is being relied on heavily by the Rangers, and that's why the dip is at right now, because when you have the trust factor, you don't have dips. Yeah. You keep going in the same consistent, kind of curve all season long. When you don't have the trust, it goes up and down. That's when you get inconsistency. I think, you know, Florida is maybe in that boat right now where there's some inconsistency, but I think it comes with the play of the goaltenders.
I would say Tampa more than Florida.
Tampa has. Yeah. Oh, quick question for you. I was talking to Kevin Woodley last night about Vasilevskiy. Have you ever, like, changed skates in season and tried something different? Because I pulled out the numbers. You know, Vasi's got these new Bauer Connect skates and whatnot. Since he changed into the skates, he has a 9.11 save percentage. Before that, he had a 9.27. You know, but goalies are different now. They wear the gear right out of the box. We used to take, like, weeks and months to break him in and feel comfortable with it.
Yeah, well, my quick answer to that is, I mean, it takes a lot to get there, but I only backed up one National Hockey League game as a goaltender.
Well, yeah,
so I worried too much about this stuff, and, you know, I was one of these guys that was dead silent if I was playing as opposed to a different guy if I wasn't. But I can't get over the fact that they wear the pads right out of the box. That's something to think about with changing skates. Like, it's Anderson, for instance, he's using these true skates.
Yeah.
And I know that the thought process behind him is, instead of having three pieces between the boot, the bracket, and the blade, it's really only two. And that should allow you to transfer your energy more explosively and more quickly. And Anderson, for instance, who just moved into a new set of the Trues, so same scape, a new set, he actually, right before he moved in, one of the equipment managers, a former goaltender, George Alves, made the skates sharper. He deepened the hollow, and Freddie made a save in overtime in Philadelphia before that particular Monday afternoon. Brett Pesce won it, where he had to lean on every bit of that explosive power because those skates had to be sharper before the new ones arrived. So it's, I can't believe it. Antti Raanta just wore a set of pads that were right out of the box for a game. He's beaten Pittsburgh twice. That has changed completely. Well, it's a great question about
Dustin
the skates.
Dustin Tokarski doesn't. I'll tell you this. Ticker here is more of an old school guy.
He looks like Benny Lemieux back there.
And maybe a little bit of Artur Zerbe in him, too.
The pads that he's wearing right now, Tokarski's pads, are from last season. Yeah. He practices with another set because he doesn't want to wear them down. He likes the old foam-injected, like, sticks with the wood, and not the one core kind of Kevlar or whatever material they have now for the sticks. So he's an older type, old-minded goaltender. But yeah, a lot of the new guys, right? New skates, new gear. Let's go.
That's remarkable.
The one thing I would say with the, you know, the locking it down and the trust and the style of play, it's harder to be that way now, no matter how good you are, because the nature of the game is, and we talk about this literally every day on the show, ad nauseum probably for some, but it can't be overstated in my opinion. 2 and 3 goal leads disappear in every game, no matter whether it's Colorado or Florida. Like, think of Florida just recently, the game against Montreal. I was watching the game. It was 4-1 for the Panthers. I flip over to another, go back. It's 4-4 instantly. This is Montreal. This is not an offensive juggernaut. It happens all the time. And then we saw it all through the weekend again. 3-goal lead, Rangers, Flyers, right? Rangers
four
come back.
4-goal lead, 6-2 was
exactly.
The
Panthers. We just had two teams going head-to-head that had overcome 4-goal deficits. So the point is, it's necessary, yes, for a goalie to have that trust in the team. But I don't think you can believe that it's, you know, that it's always going to be there in the sense of the style of play is just so different, and we're seeing such an uptick in goal scoring that it's just hard to combat that. No matter how much faith you have in your system, you're going to go through these wild emotional swings now. And I think from a goalie perspective, that's you know, something you guys didn't have to go through as much. The games were a little tighter, I would say, especially the Rangers style that you were playing back.
Yeah, and it's funny because I think there's more goals this year because the goalie save percentage has dropped. Yeah. And when I was playing, other than the adjustment at the lockout of 04-05, the goal save percentage kept rising before that. And then it dropped heavily because of the change to the games, but then it kept rising again. This is, I think, the first time that I'm noticing around the NHL where goalie save percentage is dropping. And guys are scoring more goals, and I don't know what you think.
All the more impressive that Anderson's at 928.
Well, exactly, but do you think it's a goalie issue, or do you think it's we have so much young, good talent that it was bound to happen that they were going to score more goals?
What a great question. I think more than anything, it's the creativity. Mm-hmm. And creativity almost equals unpredictability of shooters. Mm-hmm. Sooner or later, goaltenders will adjust back, but some of these young stars in the league, that creativity I mentioned, and then it's great that you guys are bringing this up because I'm, you know, just killing time last night. Actually stayed in. I'm watching the NCAA basketball game, and I, you know, Austin Matthews, you know, gets a hat trick as he chases down 60 goals, and he and Freddie Anderson weren't just teammates, they're best buddies. And I my fingers get tired texting, so I'm into these voice notes. So I sent Freddie a voice note, and I said, Freddie, aside from the obvious, is there something about the way that the puck pops off of Matthew's stick? Is it something mental? I mean, what makes this guy an elite scorer, even among scorers in the NHL? And he immediately wrote back, he thinks the game on a completely different level than any scorer I've come across. So if you have the physical attributes that a guy like Matthews has, and then the love for the game that he mentally is a hockey junkie in the right ways, that he knows goaltenders' tendencies and can put that mental asset to work. I mean, you're dealing with just a premier goal scorer. But I think so much of it is the creativity that, as a goaltender, you have a tough time anticipating. Mm-hmm. And I think it brings us back to, Marty, like when I was a young kid, Grant Fuhr was one of my favorite goaltenders. And in the playoffs, if goal scoring continues into the playoffs, it's going to be about that amnesia mm-hmm. of not worrying about the goal you just gave up and the next save that you have to make. Because I was at an Adam game, I think, and, you know, I was playing, and I gave up a brutal goal after giving up a goal. And one of the parents said to my dad asked one of the parents, what the heck is my son thinking there? And he said, he's still thinking about the last goal. So the ability to move on, if this uptick in goal scoring continues, that's mm-hmm. going to be a big part of which teams in the East and the West go deep in the playoffs.
I'll be shocked if it doesn't continue in this year's playoffs.
I think it will. I think it will because players now are recognizing that, as you pointed out, creativity. Mm-hmm. And Mitch Korn, my first training camp here in Buffalo, said, Marty, always expect the unexpected. Yeah. But it comes to a point where there's no more unexpected. So as a goaltender, you're good because you can see everything. I think right now we're seeing a lot of unexpected, mm-hmm. and players or goalies are not adjusting to it just yet. I have a video on my phone that I saved of Austin Matthews. He got drafted. The draft was here in Buffalo, and then he went right to Toronto for development camp. And Kristen Shelton, who used to cover the Leafs with TSN, she had taken a video of him doing skills work, his very first practice. And I saved it. I've never seen somebody shoot the puck like he does, in the quickness that he does, and with the strength and the power and the accuracy. And that was 6 years ago. Mm-hmm. I mean, he's gotten so much better, but he hasn't just said, I am good, I'm just going to stay here. Mm-hmm. He's worked on it to get even better, which is incredible.
I had dinner a couple weeks ago when we were in Toronto with Dean Chenault, who ran our blue line.
Dino.
No, don't Dino.
He was my assistant coach in New York with the Islanders.
He's a beautician. And I'll tell you what, and he's doing a great job. He did a great job with the Hurricanes penalty kill. Tim Gleason has done a super job taking over that kill, tops in the league, and Dean's done a great job with it in Toronto. But I had dinner with Dean and his wife and his daughter, who's about to go to Ole Miss, and he was raving about Austin Matthews now that he's gotten to know him. Mm-hmm. He said, Tripp, I don't know that I've met a guy that is more dedicated to the game than Austin Matthews. And at that point, Austin was serving his cross-checking suspension.
Yeah.
So he was out on the ice, and Dean running the penalty kill for the Leafs, Austin was begging him to use him on the kill, and Dean had just used him in practice on the kill. So it's that insatiable appetite to continue to get better, even off of those raw assets he had many years ago. That's Marty Duffer, that's greatness.
Dino would have been in a tough spot if Matthews blocked one in practice and that suspension lasted a little longer than two games due to injury. But, yeah, you love the drive, and we're seeing it here with guys like Tuck and Thompson and Cousins evolving into penalty-killing roles. And it has to be that way. I don't know why any team wouldn't ever look beyond just the Bruins and see Marchand and Bergeron and then go back to the 90s, and it's Sakic. It's more Forsberg, quite frank. Forsberg and Claude Lemieux, I remember seeing out there. I mean, you were under threat when you were on the power play. These guys are so talented, so dynamic.
We saw it with Eric Staal in Carolina for years. Like, he was one of the best scoring center, but he killed penalties.
And who holds the records for shorthanded goals in a season? Guys like Gretzky and Lemieux. Why? Because they're smart. They're that good.
Hey, boys, because I believe Buffalo, you guys know this far, far better than me, is in the process of turning a corner. All sorts of tangible hope. But the Hurricanes, at this point, 9 years and change without being in the playoffs. Mm-hmm. Interesting you mentioned Boston, because it was a game right before Christmas. It was the first time the Hurricanes put on Hartford Whaler gear against the Bruins. And at that point, they were somewhere between, they were in the lower four or five teams in the league. And for the first time in that game, right before Christmas, Aho and Teravainen were used killing penalties. And they had a big afternoon. Mm-hmm. Carolina puts together a heck of a second half of the season. They make the Eastern Conference Final in 2019. And I look back to that pre-Christmas game, last game before Christmas, of those two guys killing penalties. And it's not surprising that things took off for the hockey club after that.
And then this year, you swept Boston for the first time, I think, wasn't it?
Now I was just thinking about that in the stands because, you know, for the Hurricanes.
And had some decided wins over there.
Right. And it makes me think about, okay, so you don't know. You could play Boston. You might play Tampa. You might play Toronto. Mm-hmm. You know, the Metropolitan Division is still a real question because the Hurricanes, including a week from tonight, have two games in Madison Square Garden against the Rangers. The Penguins are there, too. But in 2009, what a privilege that I've been, you know, with the Hurricanes as long as I have, that
was
I
that
can
the,
lean on this.
Pittsburgh?
Boston, second round,
right,
after the shock at the Rock, where in game seven, Yoni Pickett instead of Jussi Jokinen, and then Eric Staal, as you mentioned, beat
Marty
Brodeur.
Yeah.
And so the next round.
The Kaniak, what was it? They deemed him the comeback Kaniacs or whatnot, but it was
but anyway. So we go to Boston the next series, and Boston, which I think was the number one seed in the division, they won the season series so decisively. Mm-hmm. They beat Carolina soundly in the first game. Cam Ward was brilliant, and they end up winning. Scotty Walker's wife, Julie, had been diagnosed with cancer during the series, and they win in overtime. Walker's able to bat one out of midair on Timmy Thomas. So me, based on that historical thing in my head, I'm like, you play the Bruins. You know, it is this pendulum. A lot of times it shifts if one team has a decided advantage of the regular season, and then you see them when it really matters in the playoffs.
We need to break, unfortunately.
We only have an hour show.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, but I'm thinking podcast, especially in the late spring, summertime, and then that way we can fill our boots on more goaltending talk, which is
and
always
Kevin
good,
Weeks so. Talk too.
That too.
He's gone corporate. I saw him on his birthday lounging on a boat in Miami. Yeah, yesterday.
Happy 47th, Weeksy.
Saying hello to all you NHL hockey fans.
That was my favorite part. All you great NHL fans.
We retweeted a video from the Instigators account. So if you want to see Tripp doing a Weeksy impersonation and the bathtub. So quickly, in 30 seconds, why the bathtub?
When he was playing, he was known at home. He needed his place in Raleigh to have a bathtub. And on the road, he was known nocturnally, even if he was starting, to his ritual baths late at night and dinners at around 11 o'clock at night. So hence the bathtub.
Amazing. So many Weeksy stories. All right, Tripper, great to see you. Glad
thank
you're
you.
Here tonight. And thank you again for the kind words about the RJ ceremony. We were all
you
just...
You guys made the night perfect.
Well, RJ.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Delivered as he always has.